Thank you, sir. You are. Good morning, friends. It's really nice to be in the city. Such a pleasant place, nice weather. Yesterday we landed this evening and we had a very warm welcome. I should first thank the organizers of the conference. It's not very often that the regulator is asked to be the chief guest at a modernization summit, because the regulators are looked upon as people who try to control, who try to say no, don't do that. But we do have a role in modernization. So I would like to make my opening remarks with very few observations. What drives modernization? What is that? The other is, what does ERA got to do with it? So when you look at what drives modernization, yesterday Mr. Shankar, who is a member, and I, we boarded the flight from Delhi Terminal 1B, and as we were boarding, we found a whole lot of people sitting there. It's like a bus station or railway station or something. And I suddenly, we were talking about it, and I suddenly remembered, you know, 1985, 82 and all that. Then I started flying, you know, as on the commercial side, in commercial aircraft, maybe 35 years ago. We just used to come, take the boarding card, get into the flight. Nothing else to do. Very few flights, very few bays. I don't think there were aero bridges. Now when I look at it, the scene has changed so much. In fact, I think Dyer came up with a coffee table book, then and now. How it was before they took over, that was 2006. And then how it is today, be 2014 or 2015. Now, the basic thing is, a lot of people have taken to travel by air. And now with the government saying, today desh ke hum nagrik udan, and competing with the railways for travel, you find that most of the airports so congested. Delhi, Terminal 1. Bangalore, badly congested. Mumbai, congested not only from the terminal side but also from the air side. And we find that many of the airports are expanding capacity, both at the terminal side and also the air side. You see, in Mumbai we have about 50 movements in an hour. Somebody taking off, somebody landing. There's only one landing. So we find that things have become more and more complicated. The quantum of services that they provide, the airports provide today, is very, very large. And with a growth of 20% in traffic, it's bound to get worse. Of course, hopefully the regional connectivity scheme will spread it to some towns, but then again, you will find that the major centers, the metros, get more and more congested as more and more people take up to fly. So the first thing is the numbers. Many numbers, you know, they need more facilities. That is the first thing that we need. And we also find that the passenger expectations today. I will divide this into two: passenger expectations of the basic services, entry into the airport, check-in, security, and boarding. this is something which is very basic. Here, the importance is that the service time should be kept. So there's always some anxiety, shall I like catch the flight or not? Especially when the passenger is late. Like in a place like Bangalore, you have a very large, population going and very, very poor traffic services, traffic in the roads, and the access to the airport is also difficult for many people from various parts of the city. So they reach the airport in time and then maybe a little late, and then there is an anxiety, will I get into the airport, will I do my check-in properly, will I do my baggage check-in, and then will I get on to the flight. This is where Kerala comes in. We look at the basic services, basic aeronautical services. But the expectations have become much more. These days we find people come in and say, let's go shopping in the airport. So it's a concept which we never had, because we always thought the airport, whatever we are going to buy in the airport or whatever services are provided are going to be much more costly than outside. But then, the airports have also grown. They have also started providing various services. Now, if you look at it, even Bangalore, I think you can have a foot massage in the before you want to, board the train, board the flight. Last time I got one. There's so many services which we never thought that would be provided in an airport. So airports have become like a small ecosystem on their own. And the kind of things they're talking about Changi Airport providing, the services, the kind of services they're going to provide, I think really needs to be better imagination. So there's a lot of expectation from the passenger so far as getting onto the flight is concerned, and also about the facilities to be provided. Now, in fact, people sometimes say that, modern airports look like malls, not actually places to get on, for the flight. And the passengers also want all these services, the basic services, the add-on services, and all that at a reasonable cost. They don't want to be burdened with, very high cost when it comes to the airport. So, this is where Kerala really comes. Airport Economic Regulatory Authority. Now, we were set up in 2008 under the Act and constituted in 2009. We've been in existence for the last 8 years. And our basic work is to fix the tariff for the major airports. When I say tariff, I mean only the aeronautical tariff. It means for landing, for parking array, for parking an aircraft, for housing an aircraft, or for fueling it. We don't get into non-aero stuff, like how much should the coffee in the cafeteria should be selling at. We don't look at that. We don't look at boarding, we don't look at a whole lot of things. But when we set the tariff for these items, like landing or parking, then we also have something called a passenger user development fee, which is primarily used to bridge the gap between the aeronautical revenue and the revenue that is required to be obtained by an airport. So that is setting and making the airport affordable both for the airlines and for the passenger is one of the main functions of Kerala. I have not spoken much about the airside. There is a whole lot of things on the airside. You need to have a runway, you need to have taxi bays, you need to have aprons, bays, and many of the airports now have very sophisticated equipment like baggage identification systems, baggage handling systems, and check-in. So many travelators, lifts, so many equipment that are to be provided in the airport. So, the other area where Kerala comes in is, we
also look at the programs of modernization and expansion by the airports. Now if Bangalore wants to put up a new terminal, they want to have a new runway, we look at it. We say, okay, what will be the cost? Because that will have to be provided by us to them. And then we say, okay, this is what we would like the cost to be. This is the norm for your cost. If you have a passenger terminal, the cost per square meter cost should be so much. We would like to see that airport modernization takes place in an efficient, cost-efficient manner. We may not look at the layout, we may not look at the master plan. That is the work of the government. The government decides what kind of a master plan should be there for the airport, and they approve the master plan. But within the master plan, whatever is provided for, we look at the cost and then say, okay, this should be the costing, and these are the services that we would be, you would be permitted to provide with the we will also request, we will also see that there is an incentive for providing more services. See, in airport we realize that as the expectations of flyers goes up, it just doesn't provide a platform from where you take off. It also provides a large number of services, as I have said. And we would like to provide an incentive to the airport operators. And that's how we said that the income from these other activities, non-aero activities, the airports can keep some of them. The airport operator should have an incentive. Why should he provide the services if he doesn't get a part of it? So that is how the hybrid bill concept came. Hybrid bill, whereby we permit the airport operator to retain a part of the revenues from non-aero businesses. That's one of the things that we have done so far as the airport. Then the last aspect that I would like to talk about is the linking the service quality in the airports to the tariff. If an airport operator provides very good service, we should be able to reward him. When we set the tariff, it should be set in such a way that efficiency is encouraged. Now this is something that, so we are just getting into this. First we will have to see what kind of performance standards are there, what kind of service levels are there in the airport. We will have to monitor it, and after monitoring it, we will have to come up with this linking of tariff with efficiency. So these are some ways in which AERA is involved in modernization, but we are working very close with the airport operators, and if they have any plans for modernization, we are very much pro modernization. We would like to see best use. I am not going into the techniques of modernization. I think there are a large number of speakers, people who are much better equipped than me to talk about it. They are experimenting a whole lot of things. They are trying to see how seamless travel should be, and the processing within the airport should be. Large number of technologies are there. I think now they are coming up with many innovative technologies and methodologies to provide for better efficiency, so that the passenger has a good experience at the airport. Basically, the experience of the passenger that matters. With a tremendous growth, this drive towards modernization will be intensified, and I think that this seminar, where a large number of people, of talented people, experienced people, people who are doing work in this field are gathered, should be able to provide a large number of ideas. And so far as AERA is concerned, we would certainly like to take into account whatever efficiencies can be generated, and we will do our work so that efficiency is rewarded and airports are modernized. We need this badly and we will work towards this. Thank you very much.